Before we start, we respectfully acknowledge this evening that we're meeting today on the traditional land of the Kulin Nation. We pay our respects to their elders, past and present, and the elders from other communities who may be here this evening. Now, thank you for coming to begin with. What we have here is Stan Grant.
Exhibit A.
Who I think I first met about 127 years ago.
Creeping around the press gallery.
In Canberra, when he was creeping around the press gallery and I was creeping around down below.
In a much more luxurious office than mine.
Oh, it was miserable, you've no idea. Stan is the Indigenous Affairs Editor for Guardian Australia. He'd be well known to you all, and I probably need not introduce him, but I'll keep going. He's the winner of the 2015 Walkley Award for coverage of Indigenous Affairs. He was previously the international editor at Sky News, and he's held posts in Abu Dhabi, Hong Kong, and Beijing for CNN International. He hosts The Point on NITV. His recent memoir is Talking to My Country, and he's soon to be hosting 7:30 Friday on the ABC, and he is about to become, or he may already have become, Indigenous Affairs Editor at the ABC. Now, Stan, today Noel Pearson described, or maybe it was last night, I'm not quite sure, but I read just before I came in, he described your new employer, I don't know whether you've signed the contract yet,
no.
as a miserable, racist national broadcaster willing the wicked to fail. Now, I mention this because I'll take that on notice. I had this strange idea that if we could work out what Noel was on about here, we might actually have a solution to a few problems. Have you any idea?
I don't know the context, but...
He was launching Troy Bramston's biography of Paul Keating.
Well, I'm sure that Paul probably shares some of that
It can be a difficult exercise, I can tell you.
I suspect that there is a feeling that the ABC, like other broadcasters and other media in Australia, has often had a very narrow construct and conception of Aboriginal society. And you can run the risk of perpetuating the misery that people find themselves in with the reporting of that, particularly if you can't see where the capacity is for empowerment. And this can really create a pathology. You know, you can pathologise the inheritance of that misery and the intergenerational trauma to the point where that becomes a destiny. And I think Noel's probably picking up on what I've been critical of myself with the media, and that is their lack of understanding of the true nature of Indigenous society, the diversity inherent in that, and the constant narrative of deficit. Now, I've lived overseas for 17 years. I've only been back for the last few years, and I haven't worked for the ABC for 30 years, so I'm certainly not going to proffer a view about the internal workings of the ABC. But that is a broad criticism that can be levelled, I think, at media in general and the approach to reporting Indigenous affairs.
Well, the ABC, of course, has responded by saying, effectively, take us out of the equation, you'll get no reporting of...
Well, yeah, and that's not true, because The Australian, of course, has done a lot of reporting of Indigenous affairs, and while some of that may have a particular political or ideological bent, The Australian, I think, did this service. It saw Indigenous affairs as an important piece of policy and reported it as you would report health policy, economic policy, foreign policy, without... nostalgia or sentiment, and looking at it through a very clear and hard sort of lens. So, you know, the Australian does a lot of that. The ABC, of course, has done some terrific work as well, and we have a Royal Commission into the situation in the Northern Territory because of the reporting of something like Four Corners with the Don Dale story. But getting it right and getting the mix of coverage right, I think, is something that's probably generally eluded Australian media.
Yeah, and I think your essay... as much as anything else, points up the sort of cleft stick we're in reporting. That is, you want to report what are, you know, unmistakable, manifest signs of things getting better, of successes. But at the same time, you don't want to report those and neglect what is, in many cases, a horrible reality for many others. And it's a fair task to get that balance right. And that's why you should read Stan's essay.
I thought with the essay, you're right. I mean, we don't want to take a Pollyanna approach to this and try to say, gee, isn't it great because more kids are graduating university and there's a burgeoning Aboriginal middle class, you know, we can forget it all. But that's part of the diversity of the society. And I suppose broadly, Joseph Campbell, the mythologist who, you know, wrote those wonderful books, The Power of Myth and The Hero of a Thousand Faces, and really was the intellectual force behind the Star Wars trilogy as the advisor to George Lucas, and, you know, really had a great understanding of the story and what is story. And he once said, every story you tell is about you. And I think from the time that human beings carved a drawing into a cave wall to say, we were here, this is what we cared about, this is who we were, we've been looking to try to explain ourselves. And when I came to write the essay, as much as anything, I was probably saying, how do I explain me? If I lay claim to an Indigenous identity today in Australia, how do I construct that identity with authenticity that doesn't try to appropriate someone else's misery and suffering, that isn't just framed around a dispossession and a disadvantaged narrative, that can actually embrace the fact that I sit here today as an extraordinarily privileged Australian, let alone an Indigenous person, who's lived an international cosmopolitan life, who's married to a non-Indigenous person, who has mixed heritage, and how can I embrace all of that in an authentic Indigenous identity? And by saying that, I speak for probably, you know, there are 70% of Indigenous people living in urban areas. We have second-generation PhDs. We have rapidly increased the number of university graduates from fewer than 4,000 two decades ago to over 30,000. That number will double in the next decade. The Aboriginal middle class has been growing by 75% over the past 10 years. That's undeniable. How do we authentically represent that in 21st century Australia, given that we also have the deplorable statistics that tell us about the ongoing misery that other Indigenous people face? And I tried to grapple with those types of issues in the essay.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about, you used the expression layered identity.
Yeah.
Can you explain that?
Yeah, I'm really influenced by a couple of philosophers who write a lot about identity. The Indian economist and philosopher Amartya Sen, and the Ghanaian-British philosopher Kwame Anthony Appiah. And both of them have written about how we construct identity. They caution against this, what Sen calls the solitarist exclusive identity that pits one person against another, that I suppose at its extreme form can coalesce around a fundamentalism that, as he says, makes the world inflammable. Now, I've seen that as a reporter. I saw it in Northern Ireland, Catholic versus Protestant. I've seen it throughout the Middle East, Sunni versus Shia, or Kurd versus Muslim, or Jew versus Palestinian. I saw it in Africa, Hutu and Tutsi. Certainly saw it in the Balkans. I've seen it in Hindu and Muslim in Pakistan and India. These hardened identities of exclusion. And that is a very dangerous, potent mix. Kwame Anthony Appiah talks about the need for a cosmopolitanism, that we can, yes, identity is important and it nourishes us and it is drawn from our heritage, but we should also look for those things that connect us as human beings. I suppose there's a wonderful line from the Roman playwright Terence, who was a slave and sold into slavery, but who was writing, I think, a century before the birth of Christ, and said, I am human. Nothing that is human is alien to me. That's the essence, I suppose, of cosmopolitanism. And layered identities emerges from that. I can sit here as an Indigenous person with an Indigenous heritage, but I know as well that I draw my heritage from an Irish convict forebear. I've been back to Ireland and I've honoured that and I've felt a resonance with that. My mother's mother is a white Australian. I honour that. I'm someone who has lived a cosmopolitan international life. I'm interested in Chinese history and Russian politics, in Middle Eastern affairs. I enjoy rugby. You know, I enjoy music. I enjoy literature. All of those things flesh me out as an individual, and none of those things should be seen as antithetical to an authentic Indigenous identity. But quite often, identity is framed around such a narrow construct that those things can often be seen as being not Aboriginal. And you hear that sometimes from the Aboriginal community. You know, well, that's not black, or that's black, and people policing what these things are. And of course, in the broader population, someone would see me, privileged, middle class, or you know, international, cosmopolitan, and say, you're not really Aboriginal. Mixed heritage, you're not really Aboriginal. You're not like the others. So, you know, I'm saying let's broaden that so we don't narrow ourselves. We're not rubbing up against those uncomfortable constructs, and we can comfortably, authentically identify ourselves in that layered way.
Mm. They're worrying times about identity, aren't they, really?
Yes, yes.
But we perhaps won't go there just at the moment.
But you did write about that too, and I think...
Well,
you
know, yes, the recent election across the sea has been a bit of a mess.
I think it is pertinent to this. At a time when the liberal cosmopolitan order that we had taken for granted after the collapse of the Soviet Union, what Francis Fukuyama called the end of history, the triumph of Western liberal democracy as they imagined it, what did we see in a response to that? A retreat to nationalism, tribalism, sectarianism. I think hardened by the global financial crisis and the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan and the consequent flood of refugees seeking haven across the world, we've seen a flight from the cosmopolitan open borders era to a return of the nation state. You see that in Hungary under Orban, you see that with the Brexit vote, you certainly see elements of that with Trump. You see that in the Philippines with Duterte, you see it in Russia with Putin and the nostalgia for the Soviet Union, Erdogan in Turkey, Syriza in Greece, this right and left, everything in between, a retreat to those hardened identities. And that has consequences for us here in Australia, and Aboriginal people need to be seen in that broader framework too, I think.
Yes, we saw a little burst of it from Bill Shorten and Barnaby Joyce last week in response to something. Now, Stanzer, say, threads his own story and his ancestors' story into a broad national story, which is not... Well, it's rarely been told, actually. I mean, I suspect that most of the history, whether written by Aboriginal Australians or European Australians, has really concentrated on the pastoral age, and then there's a great, and then modern Australia, and there's a great gap in the middle, which I actually know something about because I sort of grew up in that middle, and we had Aboriginal people worked for us. Poor farmers could employ Aboriginal people because you didn't pay them anything. Nothing really at all. And I lived near Jackson's Track, and the people there were brought over to pick peas and do things like that. And I think this should be said, the racism was absolutely deep and in fact, it hasn't gone. It's still there in country Australia. I've had close relations refer to the colour coming out, meaning that someone stood up to them, you know, really, or it could mean anything. It's is there. But you tell a story which is rather wonderful, and it begins with your search for Frank Foster.
Oh, yeah.
So perhaps you could tell us about Frank Foster.
This, you know, I thought if I'm going to tell this story of who I am, essentially, and by virtue of that, who we may be as a people, I needed to find it in my own family. If I could see that in my family, it was happening elsewhere. And I looked for that, you know, policy is one thing, but how do people respond to it? Dispossession was one thing, invasion was one thing, but how do people respond to it? And I found an opening with the story of Frank Foster. Now, Frank Foster was a name that had been in our family but he was a mysterious and elusive character. He was my great-great-grandfather. I grew up with his daughter, my great-grandmother. I remember her as an old lady living on the Aboriginal mission that we grew up on in Griffith in New South Wales. My direct connection to the frontier. Frank, we knew very little of. She hadn't grown up with him. He'd sort of walked out of the pages of history. And I uncovered him accidentally in a conversation I had with a young Aboriginal man. We were at the same gym together in Sydney. And we were just talking about our families and who we are and where we're from, as we do. And I mentioned this name, Frank Foster, and his eyes lit up. And he said, "Is he the Frank Foster from South Coast, La Perouse, Sydney?" I said, "Apparently, I don't know much about him." And he said, "We do." And he sent me this timeline, the people of La Perouse in Sydney, who were first contact people, had done a timeline of the significant ancestors, and Frank Foster was one of them. As a young boy, he was born the son of a man who would have seen the arrival of white people. He was living at Circular Quay as Sydney grew up around him. The Aboriginal people who were the remnants of the first people of that area were huddled together in the boat shed at Circular Quay. There were fewer than 20 of them. He was a very young boy at that time. Sydney by this stage had exploded in a 50-year period. It had gone from a population of around 50,000 to about 250,000. Universities were built, synagogue was built, there were banks, town hall, paved roads. It was a thriving metropolis. And this reminder of the past was an eyesore for people. And Frank's father had died. They found his body on the street. There was even a report into his death in the local newspaper. And the protector of Aborigines decided they would move them all. Frank was banished, first to a mission on the Murray River between Victoria and New South Wales, and then later to another mission on the banks of the Murrumbidgee River. But Frank was an extraordinarily bright boy. He got an education on the mission, and he aspired to be a school teacher. In the end, he ended up teaching at a school in the south coast of New South Wales. I even had a report by the New South Wales Education Department, an inspector who had inspected one of his lessons and spoke about this intelligent half-caste, he called him, who was able to carry out a lesson in subtraction, multiplication, who could read and write well. He was a school teacher, incredibly. Ultimately, the school was shut down, and his life then became one of moving between missions and various children. He went to jail for a while. He died in 1941, an extraordinarily long life, buried in the cemetery at Bury on the south coast. But here was a man that I could say, well, this was a victim of colonisation life was a tragedy. But this man aspired to be a school teacher. A man of learning. He achieved it. He looked to find a place in a world that had been imposed on him after all certainty had been removed. And it was a clue for me. I can draw a line from Frank Foster to my life. It was a clue that unlocked this puzzle of our ancestry and how it built a platform for the success that we see in many Aboriginal lives today.
This leads to me to what I think is a sort of a kind of crucial emotional sort of question. When we were, I was talking about these people who came and picked peas for the, I remember we were taking them back once, and one of the ladies was Mrs. Rose.
Oh, because Lionel, of course, came from Jackson Strait.
We picked up this 13-year-old boy hitchhiking, and he said his name was Lionel, and that was his mum, and we asked what he was going to do when he grew up. You know, he always asks kids what they're going to do when they grow up. And he said he was going to be a famous boxer and he was going to build a house for his mum.
Wow.
So we watched as it happened. When he was 18, he became world champion. He built a house for his mum. Now, what's sort of kind of crucial in that is that white Australians applaud like mad when an Aboriginal person does very well. Mm. They make something of themselves. And where the curtain comes down when they try to imagine how hard it is,
yeah,
to get out of anger and despair and all, yeah, the rest, that seems to me the empathetic step, which for some reason we've failed to take again and again and again and again. And if, even if we've taken it empathetically, we've then failed to translate that into policy, which actually works, which creates those stepping stones out of there. Could I ask you this? Those successes which you read out and took my thunder because I was going to hold them back till the end, the 30,000 graduates, for instance, do you put them down to chance, to market forces, or to government policy broadly?
I put it down much more to the agency of the people themselves. Let's look. I particularly focus on the assimilation era because that's critical. So you emerge from the frontier, post-federation. The presumption was that Indigenous people would die out. Alfred Deakin, second Prime Minister, first Treasurer, said at the time of federation, a quote, direct quote from him, 100 years ago there was not a white man on this continent. In 100 years from now there will not be a black or coloured person on this continent. The belief was that we were a doomed race, and the phrase they use is smoothing the dying pillow. But we didn't. And by the mid-1930s, of course, the Aboriginal population is now a mixed race population. And Australia's wondering, what do we do about these people? The assimilation policy emerges out of that, predicated on the belief that we would be bleached. We would be washed through Australia, losing all traces of who we were. Absorbed into the Commonwealth was the phrase at the time. That's the policy, but what were people doing? What they were doing was saying, we'll get the job uptown. We'll walk off the mission. We'll get our kids into the school, and we'll also hang on to who we are. So my grandfather, a man whose citizenship is not fully recognised at this point, goes to fight in World War II, a rat of Tobruk, came back. They walked 300 kilometres from the Aboriginal mission at Condobolin to the Murrumbidgee Irrigation Area, where there was a thriving agricultural sector because of post-war migration from Italian, Greek migrants and so on. And they found work fruit picking. You know, that was the entry point. That agency, that capacity to take control in the face of adversity was the bedrock on which my entire life and all of our family's lives are built. It wasn't just the policy, it was how we responded to that policy. He had, you know, this was a Wiradjuri man who kept by his bed a copy of the Bible and the works of William Shakespeare. He wanted to know about the world. He was engaged in the world. And a lot of this came out in the research for the essay, and I quote a lot of people talking about the Aboriginal political movement that grew out of the 1930s was a response to this. We want citizenship, we want full acknowledgement. They talked about economic engagement, they wanted land to create farms, they spoke of the importance of education. This was agency at work, the empowerment of the people at work, despite the efforts to wash them out of existence. So I think, Don, it is in that case an example of a policy that was actually a devastating one being turned around by the people themselves to get a place in a society, and they changed Australia. Had its zenith, of course, in the 1967 referendum, still the most profoundly passed referendum in Australian history to actually count us in the census and create an opportunity for the federal government to make laws for Indigenous people. And we've seen since then marked sort of progress in many areas. So policy without agency doesn't work. And I think that's one of the failings we have today. Mm. A policy that's predicated on not on empowerment, but often intervention that removes the empowerment of people.
Is it also the case that policy, particularly, well, any government policy, but particularly federal government policy, is going, it always seems to me, what is good policy here on the map is useless policy here and probably destructive over there.
Yeah.
That it's always been, I mean, even if you just take the outstation movement,
yeah,
what will work for one won't work for another, which is why it seems to me the intervention was a disgrace. I mean, it could have, what good the intervention did could have been done without the catastrophes it inflicted on other people. Now, this leads me to the other point. You use, and I think very evocatively, you talk about two populations, the open society and the embedded society. Mm. Can you just explain what you mean there?
This was drawn from some studies that were done by an Indigenous academic. Her name was Maria Lane in South Australia. About a decade ago, she's now passed away. And she similarly tried to explain, she was an educator, she saw the explosion of kids coming out of high schools and entering universities, and she sought to explain who they were, what put them there. And again, she traced the migration. People who left the small settlements, the missions and reserves, who, particularly in the period, and this is a critical period, post-war to the 1970s, you have the massive influx of migrants with the slow unravelling of the White Australia policy. We have uninterrupted economic growth. So all the portents were there for social mobility and movement. And Aboriginal people, like any others, caught the tailwinds of that and saw the potential for that. And she tracked the people who had moved and found that they started to develop a worldview that was empowered, that was risk-oriented, that did not want government intervention in their lives. These people moved to the larger centres. They predominantly married non-Indigenous people, so that accounted for a big population boom, big spike in their numbers. But they still maintained an active awareness of themselves as Indigenous people in this process of transformation and transition, but keeping that sense of kinship alive. She called that the open society. Then she looked at those people who, for a whole range of reasons, either did not move or missed the economic cycle, who increasingly became, she said, embedded. They became more welfare-oriented. They became they became risk-averse. And we see the remnants of that still today. Those two populations you can see at work today. Now, a broad sort of social sketch can't possibly account for the whole range of variations and individual choice and all those things. And you can't just simply apply one description to one group, one description to another. There's fluidity between the two. But broadly, it shows that movement and migration, which happens all over the world, and I saw in China, in 10 years reporting in China, I saw a country that lifted 500 million people out of poverty, moved from a rural society to an urban society, went through an enormous social change. It happens wherever you see economic growth and movement. And we were no different. And I think if you traced those two movements broadly, I took her as a starting point and then applied it to ours and then introduced the growth of the Aboriginal middle class in the mining boom to be able to extrapolate and to advance that thesis. But I think broadly that thesis holds.
Two questions come to mind, and that's as many as I can hold. The one is this, that those 500 million, or that, yes, 500 million Chinese lifted out of poverty, I don't know how many were lifted out of a culture that is now pretty well gone. But if, when we talk about, particularly the outstation communities, when we talk, for instance, as Tony Abbott did a year or two ago, about getting rid of, you know, we can't have all these different lifestyles, as he called them. Of course, it's more than that. It's a big decision to close down these communities. You might think they're dysfunctional, but they have been. They work better than the hub towns, many of them, for people, and they are places where language and culture is preserved. Yeah. However, that may be thinning, but at least they're generally safe and dry, and they should be better than they are. In my experience, the bureaucracy is to blame more than anybody else. How do you lift, if you're talking about these embedded communities, is it possible to get the embedded society into the mainstream, like of the open society, without doing great cultural damage?
Yeah, look, I think we have to be alive to the idea that culture is transformed and culture is always in transition. You know, the migrants who come here make a choice, and often it's not a choice, often it's out of dire circumstances, you know, war, economic collapse, political revolution. And they come and there is a transformation. And many people bemoan the loss of culture and the, you know, people who don't speak their languages anymore and all of those things. That's, in essence, the migrant story. It's holding on to some things and transforming other things. And I think that the same thing applies to us. The difference here, of course, is that we are so small in number. We have had a history of government imposition and intervention to actually destroy that culture, and now fighting to hang on to it. It is a devilish sort of question. There is no easy answer to this. And of course, if you're talking about the North, you're talking about different circumstances. The economic growth of the South far outstripped the North. The future of these communities will be tied to northern development. They are the biggest landholders in the North, so with northern development, you would hope there would be opportunities for Indigenous economic empowerment that allows people to make choice in their life from a position of strength. The problem I have with what Tony Abbott had to say and what the intervention and things is that it's a removal of agency. No one shut down the opportunities in New South Wales. We were looking to find opportunities. By taking away the agency, coming in and shutting down a community, you're not empowering them. They're not making choice here. So you need economic growth. You need a proper distribution of growth. You need opportunity and access to opportunity, which creates real choice so that people can make these decisions in their lives. And all of those things, those constellation of factors, need to come together. Bearing in mind that we're now entering a really difficult phase, of course, where economic growth around the world is anemic, and China is slowing, and that's going to impact on us, and the potential for northern development, which could have happened at the height of the mining boom and didn't, is now going to be much more difficult. So all of those things play into this as well. But in terms of culture, I just use the example of my father. Now, we didn't grow up with the traditional idea of Aboriginal culture. Our culture was country music and, family, and these were really strong things to us that we had adapted into a very Aboriginal way of seeing the world and expressing ourselves. But my father, and later in life, who was a Wiradjuri language speaker, he has written the first Wiradjuri dictionary. He has taught a whole new generation to speak it. He's taught people how to teach it and revived a language that could have been lost. And that happened because he had choice and he had the capacity to do that and was empowered to be able to do that. So things will go through a period of transition. There'll be transformation. But the things that are important to people, when you have that choice and that empowerment, hopefully you can hang on to. But these are not, it's not easy to overlay the southern experience with the northern experience, black or white, but particularly when it comes to the Indigenous community.
I saw Cathy Freeman, who has a wonderful way with words, said the other day that she'd, since the Sydney Olympics and the high point of her running career, that she'd discovered what had happened to her mother under the Act, as it applied in Queensland, that she wasn't allowed to visit her mother 700 kilometres away in the reserve, when she established that she was indeed her daughter, she was ruled out because she was not married to a partner. I mean, amazing stuff. Anyway, Cathy said, if I'd known that at the time, I would have run even faster. Now, some people will have that kind of response. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
But it's inconceivable that most people would have that kind of response. I mean, there's a level of imagination and forbearance in there that sort of transcends ordinary human capacities. That, I guess, is one of the problems for all of us. If I could dare mention the Redfern speech at this point, I've often thought that it's a pity the thing was ever delivered, because only half of it has been remembered, and that was the acknowledgement of what happened.
Yes.
And that's only a partial acknowledgement anyway. But what's not mentioned was the effort made in that speech to talk about the way out and how we could do it, that surely we could do it. It was the year of the Indigenous people and so on. And it seemed to me after that, everyone dropped the ball, including those on my side of politics. And it took us a long while to pick it up again. We still haven't really picked it up properly. And what you're talking about is really about how we do pick it up. Can you tell us how we might?
Well, I said no to going into politics for a good reason. I don't have the answers to that, but I can say this. It's having lived away from Australia and seen the worst of the world, countries that are just torn apart by conflict, economic collapse, to come back to what is the most prosperous by many measurements country in the world. Paul Keating made the point a week ago after the election of Donald Trump that we are a better society than America. And I think we are. And a country that is broadly tolerant and cohesive. We don't have the old enmity of old countries. We do these things really well. And then I look and go, you know, how we can still have people living in these circumstances in a country such as this. And is it a failure of imagination? Is it a failure of policy? You know, perhaps it's all of those things. I'm really, you know, trying to address now the idea of what it is to be in Australia and be an Australian, the idea of nation. And I think partly, you know, people will do it of their own accord. Indigenous people, there are enormous success stories, and I address them in the essay. The burgeoning Indigenous middle class has been a thing to behold. So there is enormous transformation taking place there. But still at the core of so much of this is a feeling of illegitimacy, a feeling that we've never resolved the questions of settlement, a feeling that, as the philosopher Hegel said, man is not at home in the world, a lack of an ability to feel at home in the world that we have created here. You know, and the Burkean conservative view that society is a compact between those who have passed, those living and those yet to come, how Indigenous people can also share in that compact, share in that idea of society. There's a beautiful quote from John Stuart Mill where he says that you soften the extreme form to narrow the difference between us. I think part of this is coming to terms with this as a nation and seeing us as a nation, not that you, a nation that we shrink and force everyone to fit, but the capacity to enlarge the idea of what it is to be an Australian. And I think Indigenous people have done this. Terra Nullius, the foundation of this country, challenged and overthrown by the efforts of Eddie Mabo in the highest court in the land, we changed the country for the better. And at the time, they were squealing, and you remember it, of course, and Paul with the native title legislation, but the sky didn't fall. We got used to it. And the two legal systems coexist, and we are a better country because of it. We talk about treaty. We talk about constitutional reform. The capacity to see in that, the ability to bind us to a sense of nation that we see ourselves in. I think these things are really critically important, psychologically and spiritually, but also in a real sense, that they bring a sense of potential and a sense that you can belong and exist in a society. And I think, you know, even for someone like me, and I mentioned in the essay, the existential question, am I an Australian? Even for someone who has enjoyed the privileges of Australia, the unease that I look at my own family's past and how we fit that into Australia. I've made that accommodation and I'm comfortable with my place in the country, but for so many of my people, we are not. And I think that is an ongoing challenge for all of us.
I'd venture that it needs a little leadership from the prime ministers and people of that sort.
And we don't have that now because of the lack of imagination and, you know, there's so many reasons. But it does require leadership. And it requires an ability to, we go back to the sort of post-Trump age and the Pauline Hanson success at the last election, and the ability to talk to people and make people feel as if we all have a stake in this. People are not always going to agree, but I think if there's one thing that the Liberal progressives got wrong was this arrogance, contempt, the narcissism of the Liberal progressives, that we were naturally right and that people who disagreed were not just wrong, there was something wrong with them. And that's what we've seen in the revolt, we've seen in the US and Brexit, and, you know, there are other factors, of course, it's too you know, there are other factors. But broadly, I think these are things we need to be able to understand how we even have this conversation and the leadership that can have that discussion that elevates us and doesn't talk down but elevates us and gives us a sense that we are all heard and listened to. That's the essence of real statesmanship and leadership, and we don't see that.
Yeah, I've always felt that we our leaders backed off about the same time they began backing off multiculturalism, which actually has been a great success here. And that the whole point of that statement that Keating made was that if we can do it, if we can create a multicultural society, for God's sake, surely we can include Indigenous Australians in it.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the points of the essay is I tried to write us into the economic and multicultural history of Australia, because I can sit here, a man of mixed heritage, and, you know, I have cousins whose last name is Ludovici. All of the Aboriginal people, many of them, who moved to the Murrumbidgee irrigation area, who were they marrying? The sons of Italian migrants. You know, there are Indigenous people of Jewish heritage and Greek heritage and Italian heritage and Chinese heritage. There are Indigenous people who identify with the Muslim faith and Buddhism and Christianity and Judaism. And, you know, we are part of this fabric as well. And when we start to see that, you start to lose those harder edges of the divisions and start to see where we do connect. And part of the essay was an effort to try to locate us within the broad multicultural and economic history of Australia in a way that we haven't necessarily paid enough attention to.
Good. Well, my recommendation is that you buy it and read it twice. Because I've only read it once and I want to read it again immediately. Maybe I can just quote a little bit and then we'll go to some questions. Yeah. Stan writes, Aboriginal people faced injustice and exploitation. Families were shattered, sometimes irreparably so. Children were lost, their descendants vanishing into the new world with no trace of their Aboriginal origins. The suffering forms part of an intergenerational trauma that is at the root of so much contemporary misery. The inheritance of sadness informs much of Indigenous identity. But there is something else here, something that inspires me. These were people of resilience, pride, intelligence, and dreams. In the 20th century, they would stand defiant against the state demanding inclusion and equality. They would fight in foreign wars, send their kids to school, and lead another generation on the great migration for work, home, and survival. Now, on that note, I'd ask people to put up your hand and ask any questions.
It's quite weird when I hear my words read back. I think,
very fine. And I think it's a wonderful notion that, you know, that the inheritance of sadness is something to think about.
Thankfully, there are some hands up, yes.
Hi, Stan. I recently read your novel that you produced, and I found it fascinating. In my teens, I spent my first real love with an Indigenous man, a man who identified an Indigenous man from the south coast of New South Wales, a mission down there.
Mm.
It was a...
Was that Wreck Bay or Wallaga Lake or...
Mogo.
Oh, yeah, right near Bateman's Bay. Yeah,
down there. And it's left me with a very interesting view of the challenges that our Indigenous population face. The question that I have for you, though, and this is something that troubles me greatly in thinking about the subject, the definition of success in our culture is based on material wealth and economic agency, but the traditional value of our Indigenous population is based in other areas that are more culturally significant. And I wonder how you merge the two that honours that history and brings some of that into our society, which I think we desperately need, without becoming white. You know, this whole money is everything and power and control. I don't know that's the answer.
No, I don't think that money is white either. I don't think economy is white. Just ask the Chinese. I want to get to a point, and I feel I'm comfortably at that point, maybe not so comfortably, but I'm trying, to embrace all those aspects of myself. My partner, my wife is non-Indigenous, And she enters into our world and shares in that world, and I enter into hers and share in that world. I like to embrace those things. You're right, there are certainly wonderful aspects, and I mentioned in the essay, you know, the broad sort of characterisation of the embedded society and the open society sometimes loses track of the fact that in the embedded society, so to speak, there's wonderful sense of kinship and belonging. And I can go back home to where I'm from, and those people may not have material wealth, but I'll always have a bed and I'll always have a home. The thing that sustains me in life is that I know deep down that I can encounter anything because I have a home. Whatever happened, I can walk back there and there's a bed and a meal and people who love me unconditionally. And that sense of warmth and nourishment and kinship really lies at the heart of our culture. And I think I draw strength in that to go out and find a place in a bigger world. We need money. We need economic empowerment and success. But we also need then to be able to build on the great strength that is in our communities and not lose sight of that as well. You're right. How we walk in those two worlds is critical. Bill Stanner, W.E.H. Stanner, the anthropologist, had this quote that the market, the dreaming and the market are mutually exclusive. And I don't believe that. I don't believe our culture shatters at the touch of modernity. I believe you can walk in both of those worlds, and those who can do so most successfully will have really prosperous and happy lives.
That's a big statement. Mm. If you said that in certain parts of the Northern Territory, they might come after you.
Yeah. Well, but you know, but they're doing it too. You know, there are people there who are able to walk in those worlds and empower themselves, and the market doesn't necessarily have to mean destruction. If you can access that in a way that empowers your community.
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to know what your view of Aboriginal recognition of Indigenous people in the Constitution is, and is it important? And if so, kind of what should be included? What kind of statement should be, or should there just be a preamble? Or perhaps you can talk around those issues.
No one knows yet what it is. You know, I'm amazed. We keep having a discussion about something that we don't even know. There is no question. There is no proposal yet to take this to a referendum. This idea of recognition, you know, there's a history to this. Hawke had spoken of a treaty in Barunga in the 1980s. They walked away from that. They established a reconciliation commission. The emphasis became reconciliation. Out of reconciliation grew a question of recognition. This is a long, drawn-out process that goes back many, many years, been many iterations of that, and we still don't know. So I can't sit here and say, OK, yes, I support something that we don't even know what it is. In the Aboriginal community, there is aspects of the community who are very sceptical and hostile to the idea of something that's, again, been fashioned for them or imposed on them. There is a process at the moment where there is a consultative process to try to see what Indigenous people want, what they want reflected in this idea of recognition. And then there are, once you get to that point, then there are the questions about what does it mean? Where would it sit? Does it mean changing the Constitution itself? There are anachronistic clauses in the Constitution that relate to race that seemingly have no place in a modern society that would be removed, but what would they be replaced with? What would be the legal consequences and flow-on effects of that recognition, and how would that be interpreted at law? All of these things are still to be worked out, and this has been going on for years and we still don't even know. So, you know, the idea, the concept that this thing of recognition, certainly that has a broad support whenever we see the opinion polling in the Australian population at large, but nobody can truly even say what that is yet. And I think that's the process that we're still underway and the journey that we are still on as a country, and we're still not any closer to it.
Do you incline more towards a treaty than simple recognition in the preamble?
You know, again, the... the idea that these things, I know Paul Keating has said, don't bother with the constitution that's written by, you know, old white men, and what you need is something substantial. I think the two things sort of coexist, and many people, I've spoken to many people who are much smarter about these things than I, and lawyers, constitutional lawyers, who say that you need to have the constitutional reform to create the capacity potentially for a treaty. If you're going to have a treaty, you would presumably have to negotiate that with someone, some representative body. There's an argument that recognition perhaps and the process of constitutional reform could create a body that could be broadly representative that could then undertake those types of negotiations. So you see, there are very many steps to go through with this. And when we talk about a treaty, no one has enunciated that satisfactorily in a way that meets the contending and demands and aspirations of other communities. What would it mean for my community in New South Wales versus someone in the Northern Territory or Western Australia? Every community wants something different as well. So it's a fraught process, and it's still part of this ongoing discussion.
Thanks, Dean. Look, it's just a question. I noted, I think it was last week, that six doctors graduating from the Western Australian University this year.
Aboriginal doctors, yeah.
Indigenous. I've had the opportunity to travel to a lot of communities right across the country, and I feel the health side of those communities and it's just a continuing issue and a problem. Do you see the increased middle class playing a big part in maintaining and nurturing those communities?
Yeah, this is, you know, certainly the health of the middle class gets better, you know, so as we know. Look, it's difficult to say. You know, often the experience of the Aboriginal middle class has been one of, you know, multi-generations who've moved, found a place in an urban society, and their community and their aspirations and ambitions are probably not a lot different to yours, in a sense, living in an urban environment, in a city. So, you know, some would like to go back maybe and work in communities, but often they're not their communities, so they're going back to those communities as a foreigner or a stranger as well. I think also it's a big thing to suddenly lay at the feet of Aboriginal people to say, you will fix this, this is your problem. Isn't this Australia? Isn't this Australia? You know, when an Aboriginal kid commits suicide in an Indigenous community, you know, it's not an Indigenous community, it's an Australian town. You know, this is Australia. So it shouldn't be laid at the feet just of, you fix this problem, you're the Aboriginal middle class. This is Australia. We pay our taxes, we elect our governments, and we expect better. And we, you know, we should demand a lot better. It doesn't just fall, I think, to the Aboriginal middle class per se.
Another question.
There's one at the front here who keeps getting overlooked. Yeah. But anyway, we'll work our way down.
Yeah. Sorry. I just want to know your views about... there's been a lot of talk on and off about the colours in the flag and changing the flag and so forth. And I think having recognition with, you know, Aboriginal colours and symbols and things in the Australian flag that's changed away from them, maybe include some of the old British colours too. But having that would be quite significant, I think, because I think sometimes these issues fall in the shadow because they're not even seen on the flag. So I think that would be, you know, a good step to really bring the other things forward. Yeah. What's your views on that?
I was with my friend Peter Fitzsimons this morning, who's the head of the Republican movement now, and he's certainly, you know, got a full head of steam and wanting to change the flag and, you know, continue this push towards a republic. And good luck. You know, look, the symbols are important. These things are important. It goes to the sense of nationhood. But, you know, I'm interested in how we build a nation and the really important things that need to be done. A flag, changing the flag, republic. Yeah, these things can be important and symbolically important, but there's real work to be done on the ground too, just in changing people's lives. So, you know, we can get distracted often by these things, which are not necessarily pertinent to changing the facts on the ground.
This man here, I think.
Hi there. My question begins, or it's based around education and awareness. I grew up in Melbourne, and I didn't question anything that I saw around me, saw the buildings, saw the advancement and all this kind of stuff, and thought that was like that everywhere. Then I spent six years in the Northern Territory, and I was coming back, and I was raising a daughter up there, and she came to Melbourne for the first time. She'd grown up only in Central Australia. And as we came back from the airport, she was like, where's all the Aboriginal people? Ah. Just 11-year-old kid, yeah. You know, her whole life she'd been around. She'd never been to a big city. And just a simple, innocent question sort of made me think about it. And it also made me do some research, obviously, about, you know, how many people were in Melbourne before Europeans arrived and how long did it take for them to then, you know, to be diminished. And I suppose my question is how can we make, you know, I found out this information myself. I didn't learn it at school. How do we make it an important thing that, because if you tell that story to most people, they'll have compassion, they'll sympathise. But the thing is that we don't know about it,
yeah.
And we learn about it ourselves.
Yeah.
And also on top of that, there's a lot of Australians that haven't, like I had opinions or ideas about what Indigenous Australia was, but until I spent 6 years there, I basically knew nothing. And I guess for you, Stan, you know, you're a representative. People will talk to you about these things and they'll give you their opinion, whether it's, you know, the great thing about the internet is you can learn things, but you can also empower the trolls, you know. So,
yeah.
You know, you're putting yourself up there and I'm sure that you have this, you know, reaction and you've got people that you don't really want to have a conversation with, but
yeah, I don't, you know, I don't really care for that. You know, I'm just someone. You know, I'm a journalist, so I see a story and I report a story. The essay is me reporting a story of the movement of people and how that changes the people. Writing books, doing story, that's my role in life. I'm not a politician, I'm not a leader, and I don't even aspire to that sort of thing. I'm a journalist who tells a story, and, you know, when I was overseas, I wrote stories about China or the Middle East, and I'm applying a similar thing here. I'm interested in being in and then you put those things out there and people have a discussion and they bring different points of view to that. I think the first point you make is a really interesting one, how your daughter has learned to identify through the people because she's comfortable and she's aware that Aboriginal people are here in Australia. And Noel Pearson sort of made this point, and I think it's a good one, that if you look at constitutional recognition or whatever it might be, the idea that there is a culture of great antiquity here in this country, there is the British arrival, settlement, and invasion, and all of the stuff that came from that. There is the post-war waves of migration, the end of the White Australia policy, and the way that filled out our country. Shouldn't all of this be seen as part of the story of Australia and the capacity for everybody to find that story meaningful and important to them? And I agree with that. I am the embodiment of that. I'm the synthesis of that. I am physically colonizer and colonized. You know, I am the white and the black. I can only be from this country. Nowhere else. Nowhere else in the world could have created me. And so I like the idea that we can find a sense, as your daughter did, a sense of belonging and a sense of place, a real sense of place that we all share in. You know, it's not just kumbaya. This is actually, this is how you build a nation. So I think those things are really important. Your daughter was incredibly perceptive in the thing that she said.
Mm. Well, the light is flashing in front of us, and that means this is over. But there was one thing I did want to say. We were talking out the back about Stan had been reading Eleanor Dark's The Timeless Land again, and making the point that strangely these works drop out of the canon if we have one, and we tend to think that everything is new under the sun when it's not, and that if you can go way back beyond Eleanor Dark and find people of great enlightenment and compassion in the first part of the last part of the 18th century, and we tend to drop them off and something else prevails. So there's no reason why we should assume, however well we're thinking of our progress now, that it will continue without sort of conscious effort. And of course, it'd be absurd to think that that progress is uniform across the country. Nevertheless, Stan's essay is a great cause for hope, and I think we should thank him for writing it and now go and buy it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Visit wheelercentre.com for the best in books, writing, and ideas from Melbourne, Australia, and the world.